Good day from Washington. I am Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. We've been following some very interesting, and this is somewhat of an entertaining news story. The Republican presidential race just got quite dirty. On Thursday night, as Donald Trump opened up the GOP debate here by boasting about the size of his genitals, and I'm serious, he responded to a recent comment from Marco Rubio, which the Florida senator joked about the size of Trump's hands and said, well, you know what they say about men with small hands. Well, on the debate stage, Trump stretched forth his hands for the audience to see and insisted that the suggestion like that, that something else must be small, according to Trump, was apparently false. Imagine that. We'll be right back.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
And in today's first hour, ladies and gentlemen, our guest, James Lambert, will be talking with James about conspiracy theories and those people who make them. Do they make you scratch your head? And what is your favorite story and why? And of course, in hour two, we're going to be going over the Republican debate hook, line, and sinker. Sinker or stinker? As in fact, I pose this question to you now. Has the GOP Republican debates reached new lows? Are you voting as a Republican this upcoming year? And if your answer perhaps is yes, we would like to hear from you at 206-736-9688. Lovely, and that is what we would like to do. Meanwhile, as far as O.J. Simpson, and some of you remember O.J. Simpson, here is another twist in a long-running O.J. Simpson saga. The Los Angeles Police Department are investigating and testing a knife that was found today on the property that he owned as the former football star. And perhaps this knife has some clues as to what happened with OJ's wife. So we're going to be going over some of that as that news story reveals and unveils itself. That is going to be awesome. In other news, whatever the critics might say about the failed presidential candidate Mitt Romney, everybody at least agrees that he has done well for himself as a businessman. And, of course, the Cayman Islands. Oh, did I just say that? There is no such consensus regarding Donald Trump, they are saying. The front runner of this year's Republican primaries, who touts his experience in business, particularly his ability to negotiate, as his strongest qualification for presidency. Negotiate. That, I think, is exactly what our president, Barack Obama, has been attempting to do with Congress, but yet they are, we don't want to work with this guy. Remember that? Isn't this a huge success? Don't look at now what he was talking about, Romney said in his speech last night. He said, no, look, his bankruptcies have crushed small businesses, and then men and women who work for them. He inherited his business. He didn't create it, according to Mitt Romney. Did you hear this out of, where is this from? Denver. James Holmes, the man that was convicted of killing 24 people in the Aurora, Colorado movie theater, has been transferred to a different prison after he was assaulted. Holmes, 28, who is serving a life sentence, was assaulted by another inmate at the Colorado State Penitentiary in Canyon City after a security gate was inadvertently left open back in October. And this is just now making its news. Hey, maybe this is a conspiracy. What do you all think? A record 1.2 million people registered for asylum in the European Union as of 2015, more than double that of the previous year, according to the EU's statistics agency, Eurostat says. What do you all think of that? It goes down the list of Syrians, the Afghans, the Iraqis who have been seeking perhaps political asylum. Germany is included in that. It absolutely is amazing, but yet, in a way, a little appalling. Time Magazine. How many of you remember Time Magazine? If you say, yeah, hey, this one is for you. Lovely. This is just delicious. I love delicious things. Now, I know somebody's going to come up with a soundbite for that one. Oh, God. Time Magazine has out this. Separating facts from fiction. And the list. Talking about conspiracies. The list. Number one, the JFK assassination. Number two, the 9/11 cover-up. Number three, Area 51 and the aliens. Ooh, do I have your attention yet? This is true. Paul is dead. Made it. Secret societies control the world. Ooh, now isn't that a conspiracy? Or is it? Moon landings were faked. Jesus and Mary Magdalene. Holocaust. Revolutionaryism. The CIA and AIDS. Oh my goodness. You all get the picture of that. Wow. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are here with our featured guest today, and I want to thank him very, very much for his time today. Hello, James.
Hello. How are you?
Doing quite well. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Awesome. Well, I am set up now after that hubbub. Well, it is. You know, the news, it never fails to amaze me, but sometimes it makes you want to just scream. But last night's debate. I don't know if you saw the debate.
I saw most of it. Yeah.
The big thing that before national security. Now this is supposed to be presidential, but the big thing that happened last night above anything was the size of Donald Trump's his member. And you know what is. To me, I was a bit repulsed by it. I mean, just the sheer thought of it. What is your thought on it?
My thought on it is that it's not a big thing.
It probably isn't, but go ahead. Hey, if I had a drum roll, I would have played it. No, you're right. You're right. It isn't. I think that there is an awful lot of things that we in the States, when it comes to politics, that we should be made aware of, that we should pay attention to, and that we should seek some sort of resolve about, and not like, hey, Donald Trump is you know, hung like a horse or many Winnies. I don't know. But that was, to me, it was a little bit off kelter.
Yeah. I am pretty amazed that he gets away with saying these kinds of things and some people still think he's presidential.
Let's open the interview up. I love this, James, because you were preaching to the same choir, I think. But there was a question that was brought in to us yesterday, and I get questions right and left throughout the day from folks from places, but the question was this: what is it about Donald Trump specifically that continues to propel him into the limelight of mainstream media, even. And my comment back was, you know, too often people that spew anger, hostility, these kind of things, and because of the sheer idea that what was said was either racially motivated, motivated by hate, you know, those things seem to make the news more than anything else. Thus, that's why he continues to be propelled forward. Do you think that that's right?
I certainly think that's a big part of it. I think also just celebrity and the fact that, you know, he is a brand name. That's what he's made himself into. And it's like how you get, you know, how you get celebrities testifying before Congress about things they don't know anything about. But people think, well, they're a celebrity. Let's ask them what they think. And I think that just somehow it's just automatically elevated. Well, you're a celebrity. What do you think? And then if you're willing to say something outrageous, it's like, well, that's great. Give us more. You know, it just keeps feeding on it.
So what do you think? Do you think that inevitably that all of these little things are going to come back and haunt Donald or hurt him? Or do you think it's just going to continue to propel him forward as it has in the past?
My suspicion is that it can only propel him so far, that he can get a certain percentage of the electorate, and that's it. I don't think he can get enough to win the election and the overall. But I do think that he might hit a point. I've compared Donald Trump to Joe McCarthy, and I think he might hit a McCarthy point where he just does something that becomes the thing, the way McCarthy went after the army and people saw it on television and they were like, that's not right. And I don't think that necessarily all these back things will come to haunt him, but he'll hit something where people will be like, wait a minute, that thing is, you know.
Well, you know, I think that America has, you know, and when Bush, I tell you what I felt in this spiritual atmosphere in America was when Bush decided that he was going to go ahead and adhere to what his mother had said from the word get-go, not to run for the office, because America, in her words, has had one too many Bushes in the White House. Okay, I think that America, and you know what, I celebrate that poor woman. I mean, she has got some, in my opinion, some total idiots as sons. You know, I mean, good grief. So Mama Bush, my hat's off to you. But anyway, but you know, I think that, and as we start talking about conspiracies, you know, there was a lot of conspiracies around Bush, a lot of conspiracies around Clinton even. A lot of conspiracies now around Barack Obama, and surely there, you know, a lot of the people that are running for the office of the presidency on the political aspect of it, you know, there's an awful lot of conspiracies even with them. But James, what in your opinion is the number one issue that people want to know about when it comes to conspiracies?
It's difficult to say, because I often say that the Kennedy conspiracy is like the gateway drug into all the conspiracy world. Yes. You know, it's the one thing that most people have tried a little bit. You know, they've watched the Oliver Stone film, or they've picked up a book, or they've watched a documentary, and they kind of think they know something about it, and they kind of think there's something there. And so they've like stepped into that conspiracy world a little bit. But most of them, that's as much as they go. They're like, well, maybe it was a conspiracy, forget about it. Other people start to go further. And these days, I find more and more people are going to 9/11 because it's a much more recent event. That kind of seems to be the big one, that if you believe in conspiracies, you've got to believe in the 9/11 conspiracy. But I do think that wherever you come into this kind of wave and start to go down these conspiracy roads, the ultimate conspiracy that people get to, unfortunately, the ones who get really deep, is Holocaust denial. You know, I believe that most conspiracy theories are based on Jew hating, that the first conspiracy theories came out of Jew hating, and the idea that the Jews run the world. That's what the Nazis believed. That's why they committed the Holocaust. And now for people who really want to believe in that conspiracy world, if they want to keep going back and back, what's the oldest conspiracy they can find? It's the Jews. And so if you want to go deep into the conspiracy, ultimately you end up becoming a Holocaust denier, in my experience of arguing with people.
Well, I like that. You know, your experience with arguing with people. You know, I try not to. And you know, when it comes to this, to conspiracy, there is a massive, massive debate that happens as a result of it. Pick one issue. I mean, the one issue could be the Holocaust. Another issue may be the moon landings. Hey, they were all faked. Here is a conspiracy. Now, folks, I want to remind you that on the far right-hand side of the AM radio dial, you will find right-wing talk show hosts that they govern their whole show based on conspiracy theories. And they put their foot in their mouth more than what you can imagine. But, and hey, I could name a few. I definitely could name a few, but to save the integrity of my own show and to save your ears, I'm not going to tell you who they are. Just figure it out, right? But these folks, they look at conspiracy theories and say, look, this is really what happened. Okay, I want to know first, James, who makes up these theories? Is it somebody really smart or somebody with a loose tongue?
I think it's both, and especially in this internet age where everybody's on social media and everybody has a website, that's why you just had such an explosion of theories, because it's almost become like a genre of fiction, you know, that, oh, what's the crazy conspiracy theory I can come up with to put on my website? But in the past, I think that these things were typically done by rather intelligent, out of the mainstream people who wanted to show how intelligent they were by, you know, bucking the mainstream and coming up with some crazy theory.
You know, some people, even some political figures will, again, they will say things just to get it thrust out in the media, and suddenly it explodes. And in a way, I think that some of these conspiracy theorists, the people who do them, perhaps that's what's behind them. However, I think that perhaps that the reason why that there are conspiracies is because there is a lot of questions that the American populace, the public, want to know, and these questions have never been asked nor answered by anyone with any authority to be able to answer them.
What did you particularly have in mind? I mean, there's a lot of things that the government hasn't answered about, but what...
Such as the moon landings, such as the secret societies that control the world, such as the underground tunnels that go through, you know, underneath the major cities in America, you know, that only the elite of the elite know where they are and where they go. You know, I mean, I've heard this, underground railroads, seriously, in the States. What happened to Walmart? You know, what, last year when they closed down these Walmart stores and suddenly Jade Helm 15 was making its news in Texas, okay, in California, you know, and, oh, they're going to come get our guns. That's not what it was about. Not one gun was confiscated. So, James, hey, this is loaded. It's loaded. What is your ultimate thought about this? And then let's talk about your website.
Well, my ultimate thought is that most people have kind of a Hollywood understanding of history. And, you know, I don't mean to be insulting to people, but we watch a lot of movies, we watch a lot of TV shows.
Watch
and
it.
we tend to pick up that version of history, where it's very simple to have some powerful figure that says, you do this, you do that, go kill him, go, you know, and then it just happens in the next episode. And that's not the way the real world works. In the real world, even, you know, the worst kind of despots still have some kind of other force that's out against them. It could be members of their own family, it could be members of their own party, it could be, you know, any number of people who are trying to outmaneuver them. There is never some all-powerful group that sits on the top, has the exact same agenda, and continues to do, you know, one thing forever.
You know, I agree with you, absolutely. I think that you're right on target. Too many people, as you said, and I'm like, here, I'm all with you. They watch movies and they think, oh, hey, if I can watch a movie, then I can do this other thing. Really? You know, hey, I know how the world events go, so I'm going to base it on this. Ladies and gentlemen, his website is nomagicbullets.org. We're going to take a short break, folks. But when we come back, I want to get into the magic bullet or the lack of magic bullets, and we're going to find out what you all think. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show. Stay tuned. All right, give me just about... Live from Washington, the Robert Christian Show. Good day, everybody, wherever that you are. I hope that maybe we're scaring the pants off of you. If we happen to be scaring the pants off of you, lovely, we want to know why. So, oh, do tell. No, not really. Folks, come on. Today's show is I think it is very vibrant. It is something that needs to be said. Some ideas are out there. Absolutely. And when it comes to conspiracies, the theories, they never end. Some of them, though, just make the headlines in the news and just stay there, like the JFK assassination and what happened years ago, you know, in American history. So, folks, I really want to know what you all think of this issue. 206-736-9688 is our telephone line. Next week, it's going to be a powerhouse talking about politics. David Pissar coming on after that on the 18th. And then celebrity interview Dan Dotson. He's a fast-talking auctioneer from Storage Wars. He is going to be making his return back to the live show. I think that is going to be his fourth time coming back. So, hey, we're doing pretty good if we get Dan, and he's pretty fast-talking. Okay, we're back with James. All right. James, tell us about your website and what people can find there.
Well, on the nomagicbullets.org website, they can find ways to see my film, Conspiracy Theorists Lie. You can see through Amazon and through IndieFlix and whatnot, but if you go there, that's the best place to start. You can also get a link to my main site of me, jameskalambert.com, where I've written some articles about conspiracies and... starting to write more articles about film because that's my background as a film professor. And you can also find other projects that I've worked on in the past with other people.
Now, with your movie specifically, how long of a movie is it?
It's 2 hours and 25 minutes.
Wow. So that's did it make the rounds at the movie theaters, or is that something just online?
No, I just decided to start selling it online and see what I could do to promote it online. And, you know, it is a longer film, but I think it's meant for people who are interested in the subject of the Kennedy assassination. And I really targeted it at people like myself when I was younger and I was falling for all this conspiracy stuff. You know, what would I have liked somebody to tell me?
You know what? I've said it just... two or three times, maybe that, you know, over the last 30 years. But James, I was born in the same hospital almost a year to date later after Kennedy was pronounced dead in the same hospital.
Wow.
So the Knoll there in Dallas, they talk about the Dallas Knoll, like, ooh, mm-hmm. And the book depository for schools. You know, they all have, Texas has independent school districts, unlike most other states. But Texas is a little bit different. They are, you know, independent. They stand alone from a lot of bureaucracy, I guess, in Austin. But what can people look for when they look and watch that movie? I'd be quite interested to watch it, actually.
Well... what I do in the film is I went to the 50th anniversary of the assassination. And I handed out little booklets. They were like little come to Jesus booklets, but they said conspiracy theorists lie, and gave some kind of bullet points about why conspiracy theories are wrong. And I provoked conversations with people, and I had an audio man and a cameraman follow me around, and we filmed these interactions. But that's kind of the latter part of the film. The first part of the film, I try to go through the history of some of the biggest liars and the biggest lies, and, you know, where did these things come into our culture? Who first said them? How did they present it? And why is it not the way they presented it?
Well, let's look for, and I can't say for the fun of it, but let's look at the JFK assassination. Fact or fiction? Did it really happen the way that media and the newspapers and the general populace have said that it happened?
The way it was initially reported was pretty much accurate. It was not that difficult of a crime to solve. Oswald was a very nutty guy. He wanted attention. He got attention. The Warren Commission spent 9 months trying to find anything they could that would contradict what they found in the first few hours, and nothing was ever found. Years later, the House Select Committee on Assassinations tried very hard to find something, and they almost completely agreed with the Warren Commission, but they found one audio recording from a police vehicle that was left on. And so you could hear this recording, and you could hear what they thought were gunshots, and their experts told them these were gunshots. Later, when you really analyze the background of the recording, you could hear the chief of police ordering his men to go look up the knoll. And that happened several minutes afterward. So whatever those little popping sounds were that they thought they found were not bullets, because that was recorded after the president's car left the area. So that's the only piece of evidence that any official investigation has ever believed they found that pointed to anybody other than Oswald, and that has been debunked over and over and over again.
You know, I know that one of the conspiracies about the JFK incident was wrapped up around his presidential limousine, and you know, people were asking, okay, let's see the proof on the pudding. Well, here is a theory. Perhaps a conspiracy theory. Perhaps it is fact. This, I don't know. However, shortly after the incident happened with the president, the limousine that he was riding in was flown, or was it, back to Detroit for a new windshield to be put in it and for the car to be repaired. In other words, pretty much rebuilt. Before it was ever seen back in public eye again. Now, some people say, okay, that's really a conspiracy. Well, you're right. That's what I said it was. What do you think about that, James?
You know, I don't know the timeline of when that car was sent back to be repaired or to be reconstructed, but what I do know is that the car came back to Washington first, and three FBI men investigated it, took pictures of it, went through all of the car, found bullet fragments in the car, and yes, they did find bullet fragments in the windshield, but on the inside of the windshield, after the bullet fragment came out of the president's head and hit the inside of the windshield. They actually scraped them out from the windshield. And so there was no evidence of any kind of shot from the outside. And you can go on YouTube, there's an interview with one of the FBI agents, and he's very convincing as to how traumatized he was by this event. And he had something like 20 or 25 years of experience when he investigated that car. He was very thorough about what he did, and he was absolutely convinced that all the evidence pointed to Oswald. So some people say the car was cleaned and, you know, reconstructed that weekend and nobody ever saw it. And that's simply not true. The car was thoroughly investigated before anything was done to it.
Well, do you hey, great question, James. I think that perhaps that you're right. Again, you know, just for as many facts about what had happened in that incident as that there are just that many, if not more, actual conspiracies that surround it. which to me is a bit bizarre, because a lot of the questions that I've been asked over and over and over repeatedly, there hasn't been anybody in any great measure of authority in the United States to just stand up and answer the questions, and have proof on the pudding behind what they're saying about it. So, James, let me ask you this. In American history, and as you understand it, what is the greatest conspiracy, not the theory, perhaps, but the greatest conspiracy? What is the greatest one?
It depends on what you'd mean by great. You know, the most impactful conspiracy was the conspiracy to kill Lincoln. That, you know, that was a conspiracy where they tried to kill Lincoln, his vice president, and his secretary of state all in one night so that it would throw the government into chaos. They only succeeded in killing Lincoln. All the conspirators were caught and either killed or hung. But it had the greatest impact on America. The greatest, in, I think, in terms of an actual successful cover-up for many years was the experiments they did in Tuskegee, where they allowed black men who had syphilis to continue having syphilis. They told them they were treating them, but really they were experimenting to see what the effects of syphilis were. And so they said, here's your treatment, and then they just watched them get worse and worse. And that went on for years, and it didn't get busted for years, you know, decades after the fact. But it was a very small, limited group of people who knew about it, and even that limited group was not ultimately able to keep a successful conspiracy going.
You know, there's a good, great question, actually. I call this one a great question. Are there conspiracies surrounding the Vietnam War?
There are certainly a lot of theories. I run into a lot of people who talk about the Gulf of Tonkin, where, you know, we were allegedly attacked one night by the North Vietnamese, and that was used as the excuse for us to get deeper into Vietnam. And most people now realize that the Gulf of Tonkin didn't happen. But what they assume is that the government somehow faked it. The government set it up. And that's, the evidence doesn't point to that. It's more like a ship was in bad weather. They thought they saw something on the radar. They sent out an airplane to look. The airplane went and looked, couldn't find anybody. They told Washington, we think we might have been shot at, but we don't know. And the politicians in Washington said, that's good enough. You think you were shot at? Let's go with it. And so it wasn't so much a conspiracy, but it was an opportunity for politicians to do something that they wanted to do.
To me, that is, you know, it's amazing. But after all of these years, that there still is some sort of a shrouded conspiracy about Vietnam, about what happened there. Perhaps even, you know, even the war in Iraq, in Afghanistan, what happened there in the Persian Gulf. What is really our impact and influence on Israel as a nation? I mean, there's a lot of conspiracies about this. But when we come back, James, from our break, I do want to get into those people who make these conspiracies. Is it really a matter that these people stand up and say, hey, look at me, it, you know, here's an ingenious question, or are people really paying attention to the ingenious questions? So folks, hey, we are going to be coming back, ladies and gentlemen, with more of the Robert Christian Show right after this. Don't go too far, and let your family, your friends, your neighbors know that we are on the air with our featured guest today. The Robert Christian Show, live from Washington, will return right after this. Meanwhile, visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. We're going to be right back, ladies and gentlemen, with our featured guest on today's live show, James Lambert. Right, ladies and gentlemen, hey, I hope that everybody is enjoying today's show and is at least getting something of value out of it. Again, just as many conspiracy theories that do exist in the world today, ladies and gentlemen, we really need to find maybe some sort of resolve when it comes to this. And so we are back with our featured guest. Hello once again, James.
Hello.
So I want to get into this a little bit and find out really what's going on with these individuals who come up with some of these conspiracy theories. Are they is this right that they do this, or are they really asking ingenious questions that just explode?
I don't think what they're doing is right. I think there's plenty of places to ask questions. You know, journalists and ordinary citizens ask questions all the time. But the conspiracy theorists, the people who start from the premise that there is some super powerful force, you know, some cabal that sits around and decides what happens, and that they're trying to figure out what the cabal is doing, they're starting from a false premise. And so every question they ask isn't really going to get them to the truth, because they've already started down a road that just doesn't exist.
So I think, you know, at the best case scenario, that as a result of some of these conspiracy theorists and theories that are out there, that people that we become challenged to find a measure of truth, a measure of knowledge that maybe perhaps otherwise we would not have known.
Sometimes people, you know, learn new things that they didn't realize before. And sometimes conspiracy theorists will bring up topics that are real, like, you know, how did we get into Vietnam? Was it right? But the question of whether or not it was right is completely different from, did, you know, some big oil company tell the government to do this, and, you know, some story they just made up. And the problem is that it's so easy to just make up stories. And then so many people are like, well, there's so many stories out there, how do we know it's truth? And they just throw up their hands and, you know, give up. And I wish that more people were more interested in actually looking at some of the facts and saying, wait a minute, you know, extraordinary claims require extraordinary proof. Why should I listen to a conspiracy theorist?
Well, do you consider yourself as a conspiracy theorist or a documentary filmmaker, perhaps, on some of these theories?
I consider myself a documentary filmmaker and a professor of film, and I'm interested in film, in history more broadly than just film. And I'm very interested in the history of conspiracy theories and how this has affected our society. As I said before, I think that conspiracy thinking comes out of European history of Jew hating, and, you know, that the Nazis were not a random thing that just fell from the sky. They were the culmination of a long history of Jew hating. You know, and they perpetrated the Holocaust for a reason, because they believed in their conspiracy theory and they had to stop the Jews. Now, since then, there's a lot of people who are like, okay, we don't want to be Nazis. We're not going to be Jew haters. But if the Nazis were wrong about who's in charge, then who is in charge? And now they're looking for, you know, the Illuminati, the CIA, the oil companies. They're, you know, they're fishing around for something to replace this old hatred. And they're all still going on this false premise that there is somebody who rules the world.
Do you think, you know, speaking of the Jewish nation, the Jewish people, and to the point of Bernie Sanders, here he is a socialist Democrat, but he is also Jewish. Do you, and this is really a bizarre question or a bizarre concept, but do you perhaps think that Bernie being Jewish may be a bad thing for him when it comes to his presidential race?
Unfortunately, I think that you're always fighting an uphill battle with a certain segment of the population. I think it's less so in America than it is in some European countries and certainly some other countries, but there is still a surprising amount of Jew-hating out there and belief that somehow, you know, the Jews are some other thing that we can't trust.
You know, there still is. We've been talking about racism in America. We've seen this in the GOP debates, right front and center. But throughout American history, America has had a big problem when it comes to racism, when it comes to bigotry, when it comes to the anti-LGBT movement and or rights. When it comes to the issue of same-sex marriage, the Supreme Court, and the list goes on and on. But I know that there are a lot of conspiracy theories even concerning that. What do you make of it?
Well, I think there are a lot of things tied together. And I think that so much does go back to race in this country, unfortunately, and particularly black and white. Oftentimes, you know, Native Americans, Asians, Hispanics are totally left out of the conversation. It's all about black and white, and that frames so much of the debate. And I think that if you look at, like, the Brown versus Board of Education decision made by the Warren Court, which was, you know, a 9-0 vote that this had to happen. But conspiracy theorists on the far right, the John Birch Society and those kind of people, were convinced that this was part of a communist plot, that somehow giving rights to black people was, you know, the agenda of the communists. And anything that happened on the civil rights ground was somehow part of a communist plot to undermine us, you know, as if civil rights weren't part of America. And so much of the discussion when people talk about political issues comes down to, unfortunately, some base hatreds or some base fears.
You know, you're blowing my mind because you are so right on target. And of anybody over the years that I've interviewed, that I've talked to about conspiracies or people's theories on, I mean, it could be evolution. You know, it could be the revolution in America. You're making a lot of sense.
Well, thank you.
But let me know a bit more about James. And what is it about you that got you going on this road, seeking answers to maybe some of the country's most accepted conspiracies?
Well, I think a big thing that got me early interested in simply history is the fact that my dad was 52 years old when I was born. So unlike most kids my age, who maybe their parents were in Vietnam or protesting Vietnam or something, my dad was in World War II. And so my whole frame of reference was much further back in time. And I just kind of grew up with more history and more interest in history. And when I was a little kid, the thing that got me into conspiracy theories was a movie called Executive Action, which was made in 1972, I believe, so I was only 1 year old when it came out. But I saw it on late night television in the late 70s or early 80s, back in the days when we didn't have a VCR yet. And so I had to just watch late night movies. And I saw this movie that claimed that Kennedy had been killed by a conspiracy. And this was, you know, made 2 decades before Oliver Stone's film. And I started telling my friends about it, and my friends were like, what? You know, that they had never heard anything like this because we were just kids. And so I started looking into that more, and I started believing it. And by the time JFK came out, Oliver Stone's film, then all my friends were believing it. And we all thought, oh yeah, this is the truth, that's what happened. And then in the late 90s, I went and visited Dealey Plaza, and I realized it's much smaller than the way it comes off on film. And it just doesn't add up to me. I stood in the spot where Zapruder was filming. I looked over to the grassy knoll, and I'm like, if there's a gunman there, there's about 100 people that are gonna clearly see him. And if he tries to run to a car, everybody's gonna see him. It's just impossible. And so it just didn't work like they, like it said it did. Then I started really researching it and realizing that some people had very deliberately lied about the facts to lead other people down this road. And that's led me into interest in other conspiracies like 9/11, Holocaust denial, and things.
Now, how long, James, have you been living in Texas?
I'm not living in Texas anymore. I went to graduate school there.
Okay.
So I lived there for 4 years. Went to graduate school, and then I worked on a film down there for a year. Film called TV Junkie that was a very interesting film about a reporter who was a crackhead. and he just destroyed his life because of crack. But he documented his destruction on videotape. And so we made a film out of, you know, what he had filmed of his life.
Now, that's an interesting concept. But, you know, in Texas, now I was born in Dallas, spent, you know, several years living in Texas. I was smart enough to leave. hey, I mean, come on, I've got to be honest. I was smart enough to leave. It's not that I don't like Texas, right? It's just that my horizons were not in Texas. And I tell you, I've been living in Washington now for 22 years, and I'd move here all over again. I really would. Because, you know, Washington has an awful lot of things that Texas doesn't have. It's more progressive. And which really brings me to this question, James. Do you think that conspiracy theorists are more progressive, or do you think that they are really right-wing?
I think that they are on both sides, and that's, I give examples in my film. The very first thing that came out about the Kennedy assassination was from the John Birch Society. It was in their magazine called American Opinion, and it was published just a couple months after the assassination, before the Warren Commission had released its report. It was written by a man named Ravello Oliver, who was a university professor of like classical literature, and he's a very well-educated, very smart man, but he was so steeped in this conspiracy stuff and the John Birch Society view of the world that he believed that Kennedy was a communist agent and he had been killed by the communists because he wasn't effective enough. He hadn't turned America to communism, so they were going to kill him and then blame it on the right wing so that they could take over as the communists. And he had this whole elaborate thing that he believed. He became even so radical that he later got kicked out of the John Birch Society and he became a Holocaust-denying Jew hater, because that's where you go when you keep going down that road. On the other side, though, what really became popular was not the right-wing version of what happened, but the left-wing version. And that was done by people like Mark Lane, who tried to be the lawyer for Oswald with the Warren Commission. The Warren Commission said, he's a dead man, he doesn't get a lawyer. We never give a lawyer to a dead man. And then Lane said, well, then you're not giving him a fair hearing. And Lane started making documentaries and writing books and giving speeches. And he really drummed up a lot of this, you know, anti-Warren Commission stuff, but his was all from the left. He was very much thinking, you know, big oil companies, Texas millionaires, that they all did it.
You know, it's amazing, not surprising, but amazing to me that after all of these years that there still is such a hot issue. And according to Time Magazine, that is the number one conspiracy in the States, is what happened to JFK. Who actually did it? How did it occur? Where's the proof on the pudding? Do you know, James, of any proof on the pudding as to back up what the actual facts are? Are they on public display, or where would you find them?
Well, I think that the Warren Report is a surprisingly good report, especially for a government document. You know, it is not that dry, it is not that dull, and they took 9 months to do that report. And Earl Warren, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, he had been a prosecutor for a decade in California. Then he was Attorney General of California. Then he was 3-time governor of California before he got on the Supreme Court. He was very familiar with murder cases. He knew how to look at evidence. And I think he was very thorough at laying that out. A lot of the, you know, a lot of the photographs and stuff that are in the Warren report are very clear as to what the facts are. And the actual documents, the actual bullets, the actual bloody clothes that Kennedy was wearing, all that stuff is still preserved in the National Archive. And they won't just let just anybody in because the Kennedy family doesn't want it to be exploited and everybody taking pictures and showing the bloody clothes. But they will honor any kind of request from, you know, forensic pathologists, you know, serious kind of journalists and historians who want somebody to go in there and look at it. And every single time that somebody looks at it, they come to the same conclusions that the Warren Commission told the truth.
You know, it's amazing. You know, I think that a lot of people, and yet again, this is, and I've heard it, a lot of people are saying, you know, the government is not going to tell the truth with what happened. They know what happened. They're, you know, so what everybody else is getting is fabricated. And, you know, it is something so totally offbeat. It's not the way it happened. Okay. And then suddenly you get conspiracy theorists that are all over this. You know, James, early at the beginning of the show with you, the interview with you, you know, more or less I was asking, is there any truth to these theories? Or is there any truth to what the facts, and I put these in parentheses, what they are, or is all this really a bunch of hogwash?
Well, as far as the Kennedy case is concerned, it's a bunch of hogwash. But the reasons that propel people to believe in conspiracy theories oftentimes, say like Watergate, you know, there's really strong reasons why people mistrust the government. But you also need to step back and say, okay, what are the parameters of what is, you know, capable? In Watergate, you couldn't keep a half a dozen people from talking, you know, after 2 weeks. So to think that you can have a conspiracy that goes through all three branches of the federal government, state and local officials in Texas and Dallas, private industry officials, you know, who like sold Oswald the gun and everything, that you can have something that goes through all these people, and then all these investigators from the FBI, from the Warren Commission, and further investigations from the House Select Committee, there are too many people with too many agendas to think that they're all going to be on the same piece of paper. So it is always reasonable to ask a question, is somebody lying? But when you've got hundreds of people that all say, we've looked at the facts and they tell us this, it's impossible to get that many people to go along with it.
You know, surely, you know, James, there are a lot of things that the government does not talk about, and for good reason. Which, you know, again, hey, modern day stuff, Snowden. And the issue of Snowden, you know, it had been asked before, you know, do I personally support what he did? I would have to say I do support what he did. However, just because you may have access to certain data, certain information, it does not necessarily give you the right to expose it. We shouldn't be doing that. I mean, national security, that's one thing. Again, it's a conspiracy. So we have just a couple of minutes left, James. What is your thought on Snowden?
My thought on Snowden is that I don't approve of what he did. I think if you really felt that you were doing the right thing, then you would stand in this country and do the right thing. You wouldn't run to China and you wouldn't run to Russia. And, you know, I'm sorry if I'm being insulting to him, you know, in his personal safety. But it seems to me, you know, the guy who released the Pentagon Papers, he stayed here and he faced a trial. And he, you know, was not convicted. I don't remember how long that went on. But I think if you really had those convictions, you go through hell for those convictions. And you don't just run off to a far worse place, Russia, to sit back and criticize the United States. It strikes me all wrong.
You know, I hear what you're saying, and I agree with the majority of it. I'll say the majority of it. Folks, I always like to leave a little slack, right? And that slack is in that line there, right? For compromise. Because, you know, my mind is continually growing. I'm continually being challenged, continually looking for a measure of truth, and never thinking for a moment's time that what I know as to be fact is the only truth or the only avenue of truth that there is. Hey, I'm open. You know, I like to be an open book. Well, James, you know what? I would love to have you back on a live show again in the future. You have been phenomenal.
Well, thank you.
And you have a lot to say. So, folks, his website is nomagicbullets.org. Are you on Twitter, by the way?
Yes, as James K. Lambert.
All right. So people can follow you at James K. Lambert. Yep. Get a hold of you if they would like to do so.
All right. Thank you very much.
All right. Thanks for your help. And you have a fantastic day for what's left of it.
Thank you. You too.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, hey, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. We're going to take off on our short little break, and we will be back. And yes, don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, that you can, of course, visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. All right. And thank you to our guest, James Lambert. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be back to the airwaves here in a moment. Stand by for hour two of the Robert Christian Show.